Don't let anybody make you think that God chose America as his divine messianic force to be a sort of policeman of the whole world. God has a way of standing before the nations with judgment, and it seems that I can hear God saying to America, you are too arrogant. And if you don't change your ways, I will rise up and break the backbone of your power.
Hotep, which in the language of ancient Egypt means we come with justice in peace. Welcome to Freedom Now, a Saturday Pan-Africanist and Internationalist World Affairs program. Freedom Now is committed to the principle of the rights of all peoples and nations to self-determination. We thank you deeply for your contribution to KPFK, which permits programs like Freedom Now to stay on the air. In this era of corporate acquisition and co-optation of all dissident media, we provide the microphone challenging their corporate and racist point of view. So stay tuned for Agenda here at Freedom Now.
Fellas, I'm ready to get up and do my thing. I want to get into it, man, you know.
Peace, Hoteps, and wisdom to all of our faithful and devoted listeners out there in the radio verse. This is Brother Brandon Sankara, and I want to start things off with a thank you to all of you listeners out there who continue to support Freedom Now through this latest season of Fun Drive. You keep us on our mission and allow us to bring you our agenda for today, Saturday, February 25th, 2023. We begin with our dear sister Luyanda Kaboka riding the waves of history, giving us the African drumbeat historical calendar for the week, reminding us that every day is a day in African history. After that, Dr. Gerald Horne will be in conversation with Timothy D. Walker, professor of history at the University of Massachusetts at Dartmouth and editor of the book Sailing to Freedom: Maritime Dimensions of the Underground Railroad. These two will be discussing the Underground Railroad and its lesser-known tracks that lead out onto the water. Stay tuned and find out how the water once pushed our ticket to freedom not long ago. Then, in the second half of our program, we'll be hearing from a local legend of organizing and freedom struggle right here in Los Angeles, a founder of the Community Alert Patrol, a founder of the LA Office of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, aka SNCC. None other than Ron Wilkins will be here to speak with Dr. Gerald Horne. The topic at hand is the fight for freedom of Jamil al-Amin, formerly known as H-Rap Brown, and now is the time to bring this brother home. It's all right here on Freedom Now. Now, while we are in Fun Drive and still able to bring you this much quality content, context, and perspective, we want to remind you to call 818-985-KPFK. That's 818-985-5735. Or go online to kpfk.org and pledge your support to the station at any level. Remember, these are all tax-deductible donations, and you can become a member for as low as $25 and help Freedom Now stay on the air to bring you this type of quality programming. So hop on that phone line and call 818-985-KPFK. That's 818-985-5735, and make your pledge today for $25, $50, or maybe even $100 or more to help support our efforts here at Freedom Now. I'm going to be on these ones and twos as we pour this knowledge, making sure your mental cup runneth over with revolutionary wisdom white here to quench your mental thirst on Freedom Now, KPFK 90.7 FM in Los Angeles and KPFK.org streaming live on the web. to make sure that we stay on a smooth ride with that cultural vibe you know and love, we'll be enjoying a musical bottom featuring Sizzla, Freddie Hubbard, Charlie Parker, Duke Pearson, Bobby Hutcherson, and Miles Davis. Now, people, get ready for this train to come and taking you one step closer to mental liberation, and stay tuned for that beat of the historical drum and a conversation with Dr. Gerald Horne and Professor William Sykes.
Molweni Ekaya, this is Sister Luyanda with the African Drumbeat Historical Calendar for the week of February 22nd. February 22nd, 1832. First African Women's Anti-Slavery Society established in the United States. A number and a variety of such women's anti-slavery groups are documented in the abolitionist press of these times, establishing the connection between the suffrage and freedom movements. Free African women were active in these societies, many of which were actually racially mixed. February 23rd, 1868, W.E.B. Du Bois, scholar and Pan-Africanist, is born. February 24th, CIA-inspired military coup deposes President Nkrumah, leader of the Pan-African movement and established neo-colonial rule in Ghana, 1966. February 25th, 1936, Russian-American Rose Pesoda arrived as an organizer for the Goodyear Rubber Workers sit-in, the first in the U.S., lifelong anarcho-syndicalist, a waste maker in the garment industry, and then a union organizer for the International Ladies Garment Workers Union, and later the Congress of Industrial Organizations. February 25th, settler colonialism intensified in colonial U.S. as law is passed, giving rewards for Indian scalps, 1745. February 26th, 1938 to June 8th, 1938. The national dollar store chain owned the largest garment factory in San Francisco, Chinatown. When its owner, Zhong Shung, tried to implement part-time shifts, the 200 mostly Chinese-American women workers protested, demanding a nine-hour full-time workday and a union representation. They went on strike for 14 weeks with support of the ILGW and Chinese-American leftist organizations. The workers won their demands after a bitterly fought battle both in and out of courts. February 26, 1978, Mangaliso Sobukwe, founder of the Pan-African Congress of Azania, dies. February 27, 1890, to November 29th, 1989. Barbados born African healthcare activist devoted her life to battling racial discrimination in the education and employment of African nurses. She helped to establish Harlem's first inpatient facility for African patients with tuberculosis and one of the few city hospitals where African physicians were permitted to treat their patients. February 27, Oglala Sioux Nation fought U.S. government over occupation at Wounded Knee in 1973. The
historical calendar is such a great tradition and reminder of the importance of freedom now, here on KPFK, and we need your support to keep that tradition alive, so call 818-985-KPFK, that's 818-985-5735, or go online to kpfk.org to donate and pledge your support, and you can bring home some great wisdom for your bookshelf. That's right. Call 818-985-KPFK. That's 818-985-5735. Or go online to kpfk.org to donate right now. I now send you over to Dr. Gerald Horne, who's being joined on the line by Professor Timothy D. Walker. Take it away, Dr. Horne.
This is Gerald Horne for KPFK, kpfk.org. And with me on the line is Timothy D. Walker, professor of history at the University of Massachusetts at Dartmouth and editor of the book, Sailing to Freedom, Maritime Dimensions of the Underground Railroad. Thank you for joining us on Freedom Now, KPFK Los Angeles, Timothy D. Walker.
Thank you so much. I'm very pleased to be here.
And we're pleased to have you. Now, I know you're going to talk to us about the Underground Railroad, but our audience should know, for example, that when Black Panther leaders, Eldridge Cleaver and Huey P. Newton, were seeking to flee the United States, both of them fled on boats to socialist Cuba, interestingly enough. Mm-hmm. Having said that, why did you produce this book? And what was the Underground Railroad anyway?
So I'm actually a Midwesterner. I currently live in New Bedford, Massachusetts, where I moved in 2004, but I had previously come to be a crew member on an important sailing vessel that was based here, the schooner Ernestina, that previously brought people from Cabo Verde to the United States in the 1960s. But I grew up in, I was born in Detroit. I grew up in near Dayton, Ohio. And of course, these regions were crisscrossed by Midwestern Underground Railroad routes. And so I grew up learning about the terrestrial side of the Underground Railroad. But I became interested in maritime history. And when I moved to New Bedford, it became clear to me that New Bedford was a very important place because of its role in the Underground Railroad as a terminal point. A lot of people escaped from the South and ended up in New Bedford, in part because the whaling business was being run mainly by Quakers who were abolitionists. And there was also a very large African-American population here that that supported and worked shoulder to shoulder with the white abolitionists in town. And so this was a very important part of the story. And as I learned more about it, it became increasingly clear that a lot of people were escaping to New Bedford, not by overland routes, which is what I was familiar with the Underground Railroad, but instead were escaping by sea. And they were coming from very far away, long distance along the eastern seaboard, up using the Gulf Stream, and arriving in northern seaports where they would then seek freedom. As I looked into this in greater detail, I began to find out things like the fact that people escaping overland typically didn't escape very long distances. Most of the documented successful escapes began very close to the borders with a free state, like Pennsylvania or Ohio. But on the Underground Railroad routes that were seaborne, people could escape extraordinarily long distances in a pretty rapid amount of time. So they're leaving from places like Charleston, South Carolina, and within a few days, if they have the right sailing conditions, they can be in New York or New Bedford or Boston with much, much less effort expended and much, much more safely than if they were escaping over land. And so I decided that this was a story that really needed to be told because the maritime dimensions of the Underground Railroad were almost completely ignored by the Underground Railroad historiography of the 20th century.
Interestingly enough, another footnote, nowadays, when you have migrants from south of the border trying to enter the United States, they not only enter through land borders, some of them try to sail into, for example, San Diego, California.
Absolutely.
Having mentioned that, having noted that, we know that thousands of enslaved Africans during the bad old days of slavery fled on foot to freedom in Mexico, for example. Mm. I know that your book mostly deals with the eastern seaboard of right. North America, but any examples of Africans sailing to freedom to Mexico, to Canada, to Cuba, to the Bahamas, to Bermuda, for example?
So there is some scholarship about people escaping from the South and then heading southward towards colonies in the Caribbean that had eliminated enslavement by the 1820s and 1830s. Our book focused almost exclusively on the states along the eastern seaboard in the antebellum South from which people fled and then found opportunities for freedom in the northern states. So there's a fantastic book to be written about the Gulf of Mexico and about those thousands of enslaved people who did flee to the South, but it fell rather outside the scope of our book. And so we didn't really focus on it. There's been a recent publication by Alice Baumgartner, I believe is her name, who wrote about people going over land to Mexico from Texas. And there's wonderful scholarship there, but it really did fall outside the scope of the book that we produced.
Well, I do know that you had enslaved Africans escaping from Florida to Bahamas and Cuba. You had enslaved Africans from the Carolinas heading eastward to Bermuda. And of course, we all know about the countless number of enslaved Africans who fled north of the border into Canada. Speaking of which, how many, do you have any idea of the number of enslaved who escaped by sea vessel and over what time period?
Sure. This is a question that we get a lot, and people always want to know numbers and statistics. And of course, it's notoriously difficult to talk about that because, after all, we're talking about an activity that was clandestine, for which there were extraordinary penalties if one were caught or caught aiding and abetting people to escape. So a lot of the stories that we find out about, we're only finding out about a small portion of the ones that were successful. We sometimes find out about them when they're not successful because the authorities make a point of making an example of people who are caught. So, for example, we know a lot about the Pearl incident of Captain Daniel Drayton, who tried to escape from Washington, D.C. with almost 80 enslaved people on board a schooner called the Pearl. Because it was unsuccessful, we know a lot about that. The successful ones usually stay hidden until they're written about years and years later in narratives produced by formerly enslaved people who tell their story finally after the American Civil War. Mm-hmm. With regard to people escaping to the Bahamas, there's that wonderful story of the ship Creole, which was part of the internal slave trade of the United States. A shipload of enslaved people being taken from the Chesapeake Bay and from the Potomac River down to New Orleans. And because of an uprising on board led by a man who had formerly been free in Canada and had been captured and re-enslaved, these enslaved people were able to find their way to freedom in the Bahamas. And the government of the British colony in the Bahamas protected them because slavery by that time had been outlawed in the Bahamas. So that's a fantastic example of people finding their way to freedom going towards the South rather than heading north.
it would make a wonderful movie in the sense that when these enslaved Africans sail into the Bahamas, you have these black British troops who are fingering their weapons lovingly, intervening to make sure that they receive sanctuary.
Absolutely.
Now, speaking of free Africans, we know that in your town, New Bedford in particular, it had been a real center, a real citadel for black sailors, black seafarers, for example. Mm-hmm. We know that Frederick Douglass, the late great abolitionist, when he escaped, he wound up in New Bedford. Did you find any cases of Negro seafarers and sailors during the slavery times aiding the enslaved in escaping?
We do. We get little hints and snippets that come through in the documentary evidence, often things that are written in, it's presented in different ways. So sometimes in narratives of escapes that are published after the fact, we learn that a free black sailor, for example, had encouraged or assisted an enslaved person in a southern port to be hidden away in the cargo or in the hold of the ship. And so we have numerous instances of African Americans being aided that way. We also have a lot of instances that turn up in runaway slave advertisements. So there are about 220,000 runaway slave advertisements that are published in American newspapers between the middle of the 18th century and the time of the U.S. Civil War. And those are a rich resource because usually the owner would publish some account of how he thought his property had absconded. And so we have these suspicions of enslaved people being helped by watermen, being helped by free black sailors. And of course, free black sailors increasingly in the 19th century in the southern ports had their liberties curtailed by laws and ordinances that kept them on board their ships or even had them incarcerated during the time that their ships were in harbor so that they wouldn't be at liberty to help enslaved people to run away. And so this story comes together in our book, and we speak to this this process by which African Americans are helping other African Americans. I would say, though, that one of the main driving arguments of the book, and one of the things that I think is important to say here, is that our book really focuses on the agency of the enslaved people themselves, who often use their skills that they had learned on the waterfronts of southern ports, or as watermen, even enslaved watermen, working with great autonomy on the fishing boats and ferry boats and oystering boats of the South. It's them using their hard-won skills as watermen or as waterfront workers that then allows them to take their fates into their own hands, and without much aid, often, and usually without a lot of forethought. These are often opportunistic escapes. They make their way to freedom using their own means, and that's a really important point to drive home about this story.
Now, Eastern Massachusetts and also Rhode Island have a sizable population of Cape Verdean descent. Speaking of the archipelago off the western coast of Africa, that is to say that some in our audience might be familiar with the late great Amilcar Cabral, the leader of the liberation struggle against Portuguese colonialism in Guinea-Bissau and in Cabo Verde. Now, we also on Freedom Now oftentimes play the music of the favorite son of Cape Verde, speaking of Horace Silver, the late great pianist. Now, is there any evidence of Cape Verdeans aiding the enslaved Africans, or for that matter, the enslaved fleeing to Cape Verde, or fleeing to Africa for that matter?
Right. So there are a number of instances of people who had escaped from enslavement eventually making their way back to the west coast of Africa. We might think, for example, of the Amistad heroes who rose up and won their freedom in the 1830s. The great wave of Cabo Verdean immigration to the U.S. actually begins mostly after the American Civil War. And so enslavement had been outlawed in the United States by the time most Cape Verdeans show up. There are some who are earlier in the 19th century, but the great numbers of them start to come in the 1870s. And interestingly, they often take up posts in the whaling business, often running vessels that are entirely crewed and captained by Cape Verdean sailors in the whaling business in its closing days in the late 19th and early 20th century. But not a lot of evidence, direct evidence, of Cape Verdeans assisting enslaved people who arrive in New Bedford, except in the sense that helping them to become comfortable in the community here. Those few Cape Verdeans that were here would have been part of the larger Afro-American community. And by that time, you also have a great number of people who are Portuguese-speaking from the Azores Islands and even from mainland Portugal or Madeira. So New Bedford becomes this cosmopolitan, very ocean-oriented city that has people from all over the Atlantic world and even the Pacific.
Now, we mentioned a moment or two ago about the enslaved escaping north of the border to Canada, which was part of the British Empire. Did you encounter any cases of the Royal Navy, the British Navy, or for that matter, the Haitian Navy, assisting the enslaved in escaping?
I am reliably told by scholars who focus on this that there are a number of persons who come from continental North American southern states where enslavement was legal. They go to Haiti in the period following the Haitian Revolution. I don't know much about numbers or incidents of that. You have two large waves of people who go to Nova Scotia in Canada. And in both cases, they are taken there courtesy of the British Navy. One is during the American Revolutionary War, where enslaved people who collaborated with British troops were promised to be spirited away from the colonies in rebellion if they wanted to be. And many of them were resettled near Lunenburg, Nova Scotia, on the Atlantic coast of Nova Scotia. The other wave is during the War of 1812, when something similar happens. The British, quite cannily, wanting to harm Americans by taking their workforce away from them, their enslaved workforce, offered freedom to enslaved people. And this was a policy that the British followed in North America twice, and it worked well in both times. And the numbers of people taken to be resettled in free black communities were somewhere in the neighborhood of 5,000 for the War of 1812. There is good scholarship on this, and we wanted to include this story in the book, but the scholars that we spoke to felt that this was not, strictly speaking, part of the Underground Railroad, and so they decided that they were not going to contribute to our volume.
Oh, that's their loss, I'm afraid to say.
I believe so too.
Professor Walker, finally, you also work in the field of Portuguese translation. Is there any insight you can bring to our audience with regard to the translations that you've done that may shed light on either Angola and or African-American history, since we know that a significant percentage of African Americans are actually of Angolan ancestry?
Yeah.
Or any insight into the African slave trade generally based upon your Portuguese translations?
Yeah. So my work with the Portuguese language and Portuguese history goes beyond translation. I also work I come to maritime history sort of through the Portuguese Empire. But I have another work called Essays on Some Maladies of Angola, which is a translation of a Brazilian-born physician who's trained in medicine in Portugal and then later in Scotland, who then is posted to Angola as the chief physician in Luanda at the absolute peak of the transatlantic slave trade. So about 37% of the entire transatlantic slave trade is of Angolan origin. And he's there when about 20,000 souls a year are being exported out of ports of of Angola towards mainly to Brazil, but also to the Caribbean. One of his main jobs is treating the enslaved people who are being marched out of the interior to make sure that they're healthy enough to survive the Middle Passage. And so he writes in a journal about the various fevers and other kinds of illnesses that he treats, not only the enslaved population, but also white settlers along the coast. But of course, the white settlers are outnumbered enormously by the number of enslaved that are about to be boarded onto ships for the New World. So this is an extraordinary work that really gives us some insight into the kinds of medicine that was necessary to support and sustain the transatlantic slave trade. And of course, there's a wonderful book to be written, I think, about people escaping by water from Brazil. Brazilian enslavement in Brazil lasted almost another generation longer than it did in the United States. It's not outlawed until 1888. And so, in fact, there are U.S.-based Confederate plantation owners who went to Brazil and bought land so that they could continue to be involved in the plantation and slave trade, and lasted until 1888. I think there's a great book to be written about people escaping from Brazil by water, and I'd like to work with some Brazilian scholars to try to encourage that project. I'm sure that it happened. There were opportunities to flee to places where Brazil was doing maritime business, to the Caribbean, for example, or even to the United States. And I think that there's a story there. It's just a matter of getting the research done so that we can tell it.
Well, I'm afraid we're going to have to leave it there. Professor Timothy D. Walker, Professor of History at the University of Massachusetts at Dartmouth, editor of the book Sailing to Freedom, Maritime Dimensions of the Underground Railroad. Thank you for joining us on Freedom Now, KPFK, Los Angeles.
Thank you so much for the opportunity to talk about this work. I'm really grateful for the chance to do that, and it's wonderful to speak with you.
Right on.
Thank you.
Special thanks to Professor Walker for sharing his hard-earned knowledge with us. Where else can you get such quality content, context, and historical perspective other than Freedom Now? Call 818-985-KPFK. That's 818-985-5735. Or go online to kpfk.org to donate and support the show by donating today and get yourself one of our awesome premiums to expand your library and your mind. Dr. Horne, tell the people a little about what they can take home today.
Donate $100 and receive a signed copy of Gerald Horne's latest book, Hot Off the Presses, The Counter-Revolution of 1836, Texas Slavery and Jim Crow, and the Roots of U.S. Fascism. Fascism, which may be around the corner in the United States, is a combination of both slavery and Jim Crow, and is presently creeping into North America on little cat feet, with Texas in the vanguard. In order to be defeated, it must be understood. In order to be understood, this book must be consulted. Why is it that so many Black people in California have roots in Texas, including the first Black mayor, Tom Bradley, the first Black mayor of San Francisco, Willie Brown, the entertainer and actor and singer, Jamie Foxx? Read this book if you have roots in Texas, Louisiana, Oklahoma. Where else but on Freedom Now can you not only find out about fascism, but find out about Black American fraternities and sororities like the Omegas and the Alphas and the Deltas? Be the first on your block, in your school, in your church, in your fraternity or sorority that has a copy of the Counter-Revolution of 1836. Understand why it was that it was Texas that led the war against Mexico, which led to the United States seizing California in the first place. Why is Texas
in the vanguard of cracking down on so-called critical race theory, cracking down on women's reproductive freedom, cracking down on the population of Mexican descent. Why does Texas have the largest Black population in the United States? Where else but Freedom Now can you get serious historical analysis of the LAPD or serious analysis of Black fraternities and sororities? Pick up the phone and dial
818-985-5735.
Donate $100 and receive a signed copy of The Counter-Revolution of 1836, Texas Slavery and Jim Crow and the Roots of U.S. Fascism.
Thank you, Dr. Horne. And folks, there you have it. Call 818-985-KPFK. That's 818-985-5735. Or go online to kpfk.org to donate right now and make your support for the show and the station felt. Now, we're going to keep this train a moving and send you back off to Dr. Horne, who's being joined on the line by Ron Wilkins, right here on Freedom Now.
This is Gerald Horne for KPFK, kpfk.org, and with me on the line is longtime activist Ron Wilkins, a founder of the Community Alert Patrol in Los Angeles, which back in the day policed the police, also a founder of the office in Los Angeles of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, which brings us to our topic for our discussion today, a leader, one-time leader of SNCC, the SNCC, Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, speaking of Jamil al-Amin, also known as H. Rap Brown. Thank you for joining us on Freedom Now, KPFK Los Angeles, Ron Wilkins.
Yes, and thanks, Brother Gerald Horne, for inviting me. It's a real pleasure to share this information and to speak about Jamil al-Amin, also known as H. Rap Brown, who urgently needs... I'm sorry.
So, for those who may not be familiar, who is Jamil al-Amin? Why was he capturing headlines at one time in his life?
Okay, Jamil al-Amin became the new chairman of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee after succeeding Stokely Carmichael, who later changed his name to Kwame Ture. Al-Amin's provocative eloquence and articulation of Black power resonated with the oppressed while creating fear among those who oppress us. The FBI's COINTELPRO program, which was designed to undermine and destroy the Black Liberation Movement and other progressive forces in the U.S., placed al-Amin, also known, of course, as H. Rap Brown, in their sights and succeeded in framing and imprisoning him. Today, he languishes in the U.S. Federal Penitentiary in Tucson, Arizona, under a life sentence on trumped-up charges of killing a Georgia deputy sheriff. He became a primary target of J. Edgar Hoover's FBI in 1967 because he was so courageous, persuasive, and his speeches were unrivaled, and he had a mesmerizing ability to get Black people to stand up and exercise their power.
Could you elaborate on the counterintelligence program, COINTELPRO, of the Federal Bureau of Investigation, FBI? Talk to us more about that, and perhaps you have texture with regard to how they targeted Jamil al-Amin. Please share it with us.
Well, because he was so inf- influential, and he was so persuasive when he gave speeches. He became an immediate target. I should say too that I've been a target of the FBI. I found out just by happenstance that I was I've been included in their what they call the Militant Black Extremist Index. So the FBI has placed me in that index. I'm actually proud to say that I'm a member of that index because I'm definitely against the U.S. government and its policies, its history of enslaving our people and continuing to oppress our people. But yes, it was a secret program that came to light eventually. What it did was it sought to undermine the work of progressive forces in the U.S. and silence people and so on. And also it infiltrated a number of organizations. It placed agents in organizations to help undermine them and so on. Just to give one example, Fred Hampton, of course, who headed up the Black Panther Party in Chicago, the man, I think his name was O'Neill, who actually ended up driving Chairman Fred around to many of his speaking engagements and was eventually designated as head of security for the Chicago Panther office, was himself a police informant or a policeman himself. And he actually gave the FBI and Chicago police a drawing of the room at the Panther headquarters where Chairman Fred slept so that they could easily murder him, as they, of course, did. So yes, COINTELPRO, very ugly. As far as I know, it still exists in this country.
So talk to us more about the incident in Georgia that led to Jamil al-Amin serving hard time in prison in Arizona. I understand that there is credible evidence that another man is actually guilty of this alleged crime that sent Mr. al-Amin into prison.
Okay, yes, it was actually the night of March 16th, 2000, when two Fulton County deputy sheriffs who were based in Atlanta, the city of Atlanta is in Fulton County, they went to al-Amin's store. He operated a little grocery store. And they went there that night with a summons for him, and they were searching for him outside the store, which he operated. He was not there. They made a second pass by the store, as I understand, and they saw a man outside the store, and they sprung from their vehicle with their weapons drawn and began to give the man orders. As they usually do. And this man, it turns out, was not al-Amin. He was someone who had gone to the store hoping to meet with al-Amin, but he didn't find him there. But this man was also a parolee, and he was he had a weapon in his waistband. He had a automatic pistol, and he was fearful that once the police descended upon him and found the weapon, he would be sent back to prison. So he decided to not be taken, and he fired on the police. They exchanged fire with him. One of the deputy sheriffs was killed. The other was wounded, and so on. But that's the event that al-Amin was charged with. Al-Amin himself, or H-Rap Brown, was eventually caught up with several days later in Whitehall, in the town of Whitehall, which is in Lowndes County, Alabama, and charged with the crime.
Mm-hmm. Now, I understand you visited him in Tucson, Arizona Federal Prison, and it was a rather unusual encounter, to put it mildly. Talk to us about that.
Yes, I had a chance finally to, I decided that I would go and visit him and I let him know that I got approved to go see him. You have to go through a process of writing him in prison, and he has to get approval from those who oversee him. I went there about a month ago, and it was very tough experience, because I, in calling the prison and trying to find out what is the dress code for persons wanting to visit inmates there, they gave me confusing information. I ended up telling the woman that I spoke with that I would be wearing some black pants, and would that be acceptable? And she said yes. This was over the phone. Once I arrived, which was 8:30 in the morning, because visiting's on the weekends, Saturday and Sunday, from 8:30 to 2:30 in the afternoon, I got there right at 8:30, and the guards went off on me. They told me I was dressed very inappropriately, and they told me that if I drove some miles away to a store and bought other clothing that was... They told me that black pants... Black is a color that guards wear, and that visitors can't wear that color. So they told me to get some blue jeans and a red shirt, which I quickly went to a Walmart. I went as fast as I could. It was some miles away. I was driven there by a friend, and I got the clothing. I had to change clothes on the highway. And then when we returned to the prison, it was right at 9:15. They told me I was several minutes too late. And that I couldn't see him, but if I waited around till 11 o'clock, they'd let me in to visit him. So I waited, and I was at the head of the line. There were about 10 other people in the visiting room. And when I went in the area where the inmates were being brought in for visits, it still took me about 2 hours before they brought him in. So it was very tough, but it was very great to see him. I hadn't seen him in over 20 years. I saw him when he was first arrested for this crime back in the year 2000 at the jail there in Atlanta. And I will never forget how, when I presented my identification to the guards there at the jail, and they finally came to let me know that I could go up and see him, they looked at me and said, "We're going to let you in this time, but don't you ever come back." And I looked at them and I said, "So it's like that, huh?" They said, "Yeah, it's like that." And so I went up, we sat down together for about, between the bars there, for about 45 minutes. But that was the last time I had seen him before going this time. This time when I saw him, by the way, he was the last to be brought into the area where the visits were taking place. And he came out assisted by a walker, which shocked me. When he came out, we embraced, and then we sat down across from one another. And he said he's always had a problem with his legs growing up, walking and running, and we didn't discuss that any further. But I could see that he had lost some weight, but I can say that his memory was very sharp and his spirits were very high. And we had a good meeting. We sat for just over an hour. Talking about his situation and what could be done about it, and talking about past work we had done, and at times laughing, and he had me rolling because his memory is so great. But yes, that's the way the visit took place. By the way, that prison is surrounded. I've never seen a prisoner with so many very highly placed guard towers and razor sharp barbed wire. Everywhere you look, there's barbed wire. But anyway, it's quite an experience.
How old is he now?
He's 79. He will be 80 on the 4th of October this year.
Mm-hmm.
So he's getting up.
Mm-hmm. I understand that there is a website, and can you give us the website and also share with us what do you recommend that the audience do, those who would like to see freedom for Jamil al-Amin?
Okay, there's a couple of websites. One of them, a very important one, if you just go on Google and you type in Imam, because he's a Muslim now, Imam, I-M-A-M, that's Imam Jamil Action Network, you'll see some information come up. And on that particular website, there's a comprehensive chronology of his life's work and his legal cases. There's another website. If you go on Google again and you type in what happened to, that's the number two, rap.com. What happened to rap.com? You'll see a lot of information about demonstrations that have taken place, different aspects of the case that was made against him, and that sort of thing. So all of that's there if you go on. And there's some other things one can do. You could call the Fulton County District Attorney. They have what's called the Conviction Integrity Unit. And that number is 404, area code, 612-4000 or 612-4981. And demand that they revisit his case, that he deserves to be exonerated, that he did not commit this crime. You can also write Brother Jamil al-Amin himself by simply putting down his name and then after his name, 99974555, and then the next line on the envelope, USP Tucson, the next line, U.S. Penitentiary, and the next line, P.O. Box 24550, the next line, Tucson, Arizona, 85734. So those are things that can be done, yes.
So Jamil al-Amin and 99974555. And the PO box is 24550. And the zip code in Tucson, Arizona for the U.S. Penitentiary is 85734.
Correct.
And also repeat those two websites again.
Sure. The first one again is Imam Jamil Action Network. And you just type that onto Google. And the second one is What Happened to rap.com.
Now, I understand also that there might be a Netflix series in the works about this case. Talk to us about that and what can be done to push that along.
Yes, I understand that there's a Netflix docuseries that's in the works, and it would be great if people called Netflix. Their number is 844-505-2993 and let Netflix know that they should definitely go ahead with the docuseries. It would be great to get it out as soon as possible. It should also be known, we don't want to leave this out, that a few days after this other person, Otis Jackson, who was involved in the shootout with the deputy sheriffs there, this Otis Jackson confessed, and the confession is in his own handwriting. It was documented and filed, but it has continued to be dismissed and suppressed. In fact, it's interesting that while Otis Jackson has confessed that he was the killer of the deputy, and that he was the one that wounded the other, he's even shown the wounds on his left arm, because he was hit twice by the wounded deputy in the left arm, but he managed to connect with some nurses and get himself, you know, healed and so on. But all that needs to be brought back to the forefront, and we need to press for Jamil al-Amin, a.k.a. H-Rap Brown, to be released from prison now.
Unfortunately, we're up against the tyranny of the clock, Ron Wilkins. Is there anything you would like to share with the audience before we have to conclude?
I'd just like to say that I want to leave you with some words from Jamil al-Amin. He says, "I can find only three places for a righteous man in an evil society: on the battlefield fighting his enemy, in a cell imprisoned by the enemy, or in his grave free from his enemy. Outside this, I find only hypocrisy. I want to say too that he's very much hated and resisted and resented by this country's rulers, but we must not let them prevail in this situation.
Well, I'm afraid we're going to have to leave it there. Ron Wilkins, longtime activist, a founder of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee in Los Angeles, comrade of Jamil al-Amin, also known as H. Ralph Brown. Thank you for joining us on Freedom Now, KPFK, Los Angeles.
Thank you, brother, and thanks for all your great work.
In closing, we'd like to thank our guest, Professor Timothy D. Walker from the University of Massachusetts at Dartmouth. Find yourself a Black-owned bookstore near you today and grab his book, Sailing to Freedom, Maritime Dimensions of the Underground Railroad. Next up, we send a thank you to Ron Wilkins for joining us to speak on the fight to liberate Brother Jamil al-Amin, a.k.a. H-Rap Brown. For more info, please visit whathappentorap.com with a number 2 instead of the T-O. That's whathappentorap.com. Shout out to Dr. Gerald Horne for doing what he does best and guiding this train of mental liberation towards Pan-African enlightenment for yet another Saturday. Hit up your favorite bookstore right now and find one of Dr. Horne's many informative texts to enrich your library and your mind. Word to producer Sister Tej. Thanks and love to our dear sister, Luyanda Kaboka, for giving us the African Drumbeat Historical Calendar for the week. Much love to our spiritual backbone and Freedom Now founder, Baba Didan Kamathi. And shout out to our marvelous engineer, but last and certainly not least, thanks to all of our loyal listeners and supporters out there. It takes a village to build a revolution, and Freedom Now is a village to be reckoned with. Please continue to support our programming. We are volunteer producers, and the station needs to pay the bills to keep the lights on in the building and the mics hot for us. So please, dial 818-985-KPFK. That's 818-985-5735. Or go online to kpfk.org to donate and support the show. This has been Brother Brandon Sankara, and you can join us on Facebook at Freedom Now Gerald Horne. You can email the program at freedomnow@kpfk.org or go online to our audio archives at kpfk.org. Scroll down to Freedom Now and you'll be able to hear this program as well as 60 days worth of prior programming here at KPFK 90.7 FM. We now send you off to our sister Assumpta with Spotlight Africa coming up next, addressing issues facing Mama Africa. And until next Saturday, here at Freedom Now, we stand running our marathon, ready for revolution.